स्ट्रीमिंग स्टार्ट कर दिया है, बस थोड़ी देर में अपन स्टार्ट कर।
ओके, लेट मी स्टार्ट। गुड आफ्टरनून टू ऑल। मायसेल्फ डॉक्टर विनीत सिंह, वर्किंग एज असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर ऑफ डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ फार्मेसी, SGSITS इंदौर। आई अलोंग विद माय अदर कलीग्स वेलकम यू ऑल फॉर द फोर्थ सेशन ऑफ दिस two-day e-workshop on Renaissance of Social Awareness. For the fourth session, we have with us a dignity of medical science, our invited guest speaker, Dr. Pranav Ghodgaonkar. He is a consultant and chief neurosurgeon at CHL Hospital, Indore. Before this, he had also worked with other multi-specialist hospitals such as Bombay Hospital and Medical Research Center, Indore, Grant Medical College and Sir JJ Group of Hospitals, Mumbai, in different capacities. He graduated in medical science from MGM Medical College, Indore, in the year 1998, and done his MS General Surgery from MS University, Baroda, in 2002, and then completed further programs from Fujita Health University, Japan, and University Tübingen, Germany. He is also an active member of various professional bodies associated with neuroscience. He has published several reports related to neck and spine surgery. Apart from his profession, He is also associated with so many social platforms and actively educating the audience with his experience related to environment safety and healthcare facility. इसके अलावा एक छोटा सा उनका SGSITS के साथ एसोसिएशन पिछले दो साल पुराना है. हमारे यहाँ से एक बच्चा जिसके ऊपर सर के ऊपर एक पेड़ गिर गया था और उसको एक इंजरी हुई थी, हेड इंजरी. फाइनली डॉक्टर प्रणव इज द ओनली डॉक्टर जिन्होंने उसको फाइनल सर्जरी करके उसको ठीक किया था. आई रिक्वेस्ट डॉक्टर प्रणव गोडगांवकर टू प्लीज डिलीवर हिज टॉक. ओवर टू यू डॉक्टर प्रणव गोडगांवकर.
गुड आफ्टरनून. थैंक यू प्रोफेसर विनीत फॉर दिस जेनरस इंट्रोडक्शन. At the outset, thank you for arranging this and giving me a platform to connect with all young aspiring people here. And today I'm going to talk about something which is more relevant in the present scenario when all of us are looking up at a medical problem in the form of COVID infection worldwide. And I'm audible to Vineet, right?
Yeah, audible.
I'm going to talk about healthcare economics and conflicts, the perception the society has, and I'm presenting my view from a healthcare provider's point of view. So I will put forward the economics from a doctor's or a hospital's or from a pharmaceutical industry's point of view. There might be many things which might be conflicting and the audience might disagree at various points, which is valid also, because this is something which has that's why we are talking about the conflicts. So my screen is visible. I'm sharing it now.
It's
visible. So healthcare economics and its conflicts. Health, what do we understand by health? As the World Health Organization or health experts have agreed and concluded that it's a state of physical, mental, emotional, as well as spiritual well-being. This altogether constitutes a healthy person. And all of us are supposed to be healthy at all times. That is the system. And the loss of status, loss of health is an event. Being healthy is not an event. We ask about the well-being of the people. Oh, you are not healthy. How are you? We don't talk about the healthy state. It is supposed to be there. And it's a misfortune and calls for sympathy when the health is lost. So what are the bright side of being healthy? Health is a gift of nature. You don't really have to do anything be in a health status. If you can just band off the bad factors or the health risky behavior and factors, you are healthy otherwise. Most of the people do not make real efforts to achieve it. And when I say so, I really mean it. There's no real economic cost involved in being healthy. Being normal doesn't really require that great effort or that kind of economic effort as a non-healthy state would demand for. And state of health is not a concern. That means when you are healthy, it is just like that. It's not actually a concern. What are the flip sides? What are the flip sides here? The state of health is underestimated. Being healthy, what we achieve as default is underestimated. We do not understand its value till it is lost or it is threatened. That's number one. And since it is a default state and most of us remain healthy throughout our lives, there are no actual financial provisions made for that unfortunate or that state that the health is lost or threatened. And no many people who live for their lives through those factors, as we can talk about diet habits or do minimal physical activity as appropriate their age or their body structures or the kind of work they
do. Excuse me, sir.
Or yeah.
Sir, your Hello? Voice is cutting in between.
Is it all right now?
No, sir. So possibly it seems like network issue. If you can do something for that.
So give me a moment. I'll move to a place where you know the network is stronger. Give me a moment, please.
Okay.
Give me a moment.
All right.
Yeah. Give me a moment.
All the participants are requested to switch off their mic and camera during the session. And all the questions that arise during the session, you can write it in the chat box. So we'll be entertained at the end of the session.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
Am I audible now?
Yes, sir.
Is it better? Is it better? Okay, I'll resume in a moment.
Okay, sir.
Yeah. Hello.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, is it better now?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so I'll start. Was I audible till this slide here, the flip side of health?
Sir, if you can repeat this slide, it would be great.
Okay, okay. I'll come from behind. I'll come from the previous slide. So we talked about the bright side of being healthy, that health is the gift of nature. And by default, all of us are healthy. And most of the people do not make real efforts to achieve it. There is no real economic cost involved in being healthy. If you are healthy, it doesn't cost for an additional financial provisions. And state of being healthy is not really a concern. We don't talk about it. We don't really, sometimes we undervalue that status. So what are the flip sides of health? this is all right now. Hello? Hello?
Yes, sir.
थोड़ा सा नेटवर्क का इश्यू आ गया है, नेटवर्क ब्रेक हो गया है.
ड्यू टू नेटवर्क इश्यू सर विल बी जॉइनिंग शॉर्टली. सो ऑल द पार्टिसिपेंट्स आर रिक्वेस्टेड टू स्टे इन द मीटिंग, डोंट लीव इट. एंड वंस सर जॉइन द सेशन, वी विल रीस्टार्ट द सेशन अगेन.
बिल्कुल अब ऑडियो भी गुड है.
ओके
सर हैज जॉइन्ड द सेशन सो सेशन विल बी स्टार्टिंग शॉर्टली.
हेलो.
या
यस सर.
I hope I'm audible. Sorry for this glitch. Am I audible now?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So I'll go back. I talked about, we were talking about health, what actually the health is. And we said that it includes various components, being physically, mentally, socially, and spiritually well. So looking at the bright side of health, the entity of health, health is a gift of nature, and most of the people do not make real efforts to achieve it. It is default there. We are otherwise healthy. No real economic cost is involved in being healthy. And similarly, the state of health is not a concern. Of course, it should not be. What is a concern is the loss of state of health. Flip side of this entity is state of being healthy is always underestimated. We assume, we understand that by default we are healthy, so it is always, it is only valued once the health, state of health is lost. There are no actual financial provisions which are made after foreseeing and to really counter with that. And there are people who live with known risk for their lives. I was talking about this when the dysfunction started. So there are people who smoke all their lives, or they do not maintain their, they do not control their blood pressures, or they live with diabetes, underestimating its risk, and so on and so forth. And also the flip side of being healthy is if you live a very, very bookishly healthy life, you do everything, exercise, that also doesn't guarantee that one of we or all of us will remain healthy, because there are certain factors which are beyond comprehension and beyond estimation also. So what is our scenario here? how are we placed? So at the moment, if we see, these are the figures of 2019, Indian healthcare economics, or the industry, or the Indian healthcare sector is something of volume of 130 to 115 billion US dollars. It is growing at a rate of around 15% per annum. And including, if we include the medical tourism aspect into that, the growth is estimated to be around 18 to 20% per annum. It utilizes a GDP share of 3.6%. These are figures of 2018 compared to 17% share in United States. We are considering it as an index, and 70% or more of the healthcare is out of pocket. What does out of pocket means? Like 70%, around 70% of the population is not covered under any scheme or insurance. So whenever they fall ill or they need to seek medical care, they have to make payments out of their pocket. This is one important aspect. We'll see its effects on the healthcare economics as we move further. So this is one general idea about how the healthcare system in our place are in India are distributed. There are around 13 to 14 lakh beds available in hospital, which is out of which around 8.5 lakh, if we say, are in the private sector, compared to around 5.5 lakhs in the public hospitals or the government hospitals. On an average, there are 70-75% functional beds, occupied beds. Functional means the beds which are occupied at a given time in private, compared to around 50-60% in the public sector hospital or government hospitals. And if you look at the bottom end of this, you will see the distribution is very unequal. Like majority of the beds, healthcare and quality healthcare, or the availability, all is concentrated into bigger cities compared to smaller ones. And private in general, our private healthcare in general is all concentrated into the urban and semi-urban metros, urban and semi-urban situations in locations. Whereas the government are distributed equally in a ratio of 60-40. So if we just summarize it quickly, we can understand these are figures for idea that there are around 10 to 11,000 private hospitals throughout the country and around 3,500 in the government sector. If we talk about clinical sector visits like OPD, but what we call around 78%, around 78% to 80% of the visits are in the private clinic. That suggests that most of the people find it convenient to seek that care in the private setups. Whereas the hospital care, in hospital care, surgery, getting admitted, that is divided to 58% in the private and the rest in the government setups. Because probably clinical visit in a private hospital is not that costly. Whereas if it is admission and surgery or a medical care or long-term hospitalization, then the private hospitals might come out to be very, very expensive. As we said, the private players are in the urban settings and they are in the specialized care. Most of the private hospital big players are into the specialized care. They are away from the primary or the basic healthcare infrastructure or the healthcare mechanism. And penetration of insurance or the welfare schemes is poor. As we saw, 70% of the people are paying out of their pocket. So 30%, which is also a liberal estimate, people are covered by insurance. And now this is slightly changed as Ayushman Bharat has come and it has covered around 70 to 80 crore people. But it also has its own, aspects. So healthcare economics, what exactly is health economics of the healthcare? By definition, we say health economics is the branch of economics concerned with the efficacy, effectiveness, value, and behavior in the delivery and consumption of health and healthcare. Health spending is the final consumption of health goods and services. It includes spending by both the public and the private sources. So what in an economy is a standard model? In an economy, there would be supplier of services or commodity, consumers of the services and commodity. Then there are brands, premium brands, their positioning, their valuation. Then the pricing, which is by and large in any other industry, if you compare, I would not call, healthcare as industry here because it has some other meanings. I would say healthcare sector and industry. So pricing, which is determined by in other industry or in other sectors, is determined by the market forces. Then demand and supply, which is dynamic, and again market forces, which are the players. So what are the conflicts here? Why healthcare, I said, is different from other sectors or other business models? Because we are not sure whether we should call healthcare as an industry or not, because when we call it as an industry, the definitions and the motives change to some extent. So whether it's a profession, healthcare, because there are two or three players involved. One is the healthcare provider, the doctor, nurses, paramedics, and then there are hospitals, which are also healthcare providers, but some of them are owned, conceived, owned, made operational and run by businessmen. You understand that? Hello, Vineet. Hello.
Yes.
Vineet, I'm just trying to be a bit interactive here.
Yeah. So, I'm also making language. You can use any language.
And I'm just ensuring that I am not disconnected.
No.
Right. Yeah. So when we talk of business model, it is difficult to really put healthcare or medicine or healthcare into an industry, because as I said, there are three sections. One is the healthcare providers, the doctors, nurses, and all the staff which do that, and then there are hospitals, which are healthcare providers of charity type as well as profit making types. private hospitals, like for an example, Vocard, which was a very well-known pharmaceutical company, when they realized that, you know, running a hospital business is more profitable, they got into. Similarly, Apollo, they did it the other way. They came from hospitals into the pharmacy, and Vocard did the other way. And the ethics associated with connected to all these things. Then, you know, the profits, whether a healthcare model should be run from a point of view of making profits, or it is a servicing kind of model, or it is a charity kind of model. So that is very, very difficult. These are the conflicts, actually, whether a hospital should run on a no profit, no loss basis, or they also need profits, what kind of profits they can have, you know, to what extent are they allowed, and who decides this. Then advertisement. I'm a neurosurgeon. Should I advertise myself as a manufacturer of a car? Automobile is doing. They are saying that their product is best. They have engineered it. They have spent a lot of thought process into it, and they have made an excellent product. So did I. I spent so many years learning this, divine science, how to treat a brain or a spinal cord or the nervous system ailment. So should I advertise my skills? So is it ethical, non-ethical? Why in if we talk of industry and we compare automobile with healthcare, how automobile industry's advertisement becomes a talk of the town, and that of a hospital's advertisement become a ethical issue. Does these models really need to increase their business by the established industry norms? And then another point is convincing the customer to buy something they do not want. I have a very interesting example for this. Like I'm producing a paint, and I'm a producer and a seller of a paint. And then when some customer comes to me, I tell them, okay, you're going to buy this particular thing. This is good, but then I've got another product which is still better, and it will give a still better finish or look. It may not be so, really. The difference may be less, but then I'm a good businessman, and I'm a good salesman also. So I'm able to convince my customer to buy something other than what he or she wanted to do. As a doctor, as a healthcare provider, or as a hospital, can I do that? I can tell, okay, you want surgery, on I'm good, so I can do it on the right side as well. And if I can convince, so should I be doing that? And is it what I'm talking makes any sense in any way? So the last point comes is ethical boundaries. So this healthcare sector is entirely, covered or envisaged or limited by a healthcare boundary, an invisible boundary, which is very, very distinctly understood. So this is a model, a typical model in a market. In a typical market, there would be a buyer and there would be a seller, or there would be a service consumer and a service provider. The buyer is supplying money in return of the services provided by the seller or the service provider. But when the healthcare model comes, there is another entity which comes in. It could be government body, it could be some observers, it could be third party, which decides, and like you can see in this image, the financial rules govern the payment of the user to the third party, and which in turn decides the payment to the provider who is providing services to the patient. So, how this situation becomes funny, wherein, the service seeker is number one, somebody else, service provider is third, but, the person, the entity which decides the remuneration is something else. And so I could find this cartoon which very aptly sits there, and it says that your insurance company only covers the removal of the damaged organ. You will have to put the transplant in yourselves. So that indicates that sometimes the insurer has its own. Now insurer again is the pure business model. Insurance company's job is to get maximum people insured, and they at the same time also see that they have to pay out least. So when we deal with the insurance patients, and when we admit, I'll narrate another very interesting scenario. I'm a spinal surgeon as well, brain and spinal surgeon. So I get patients who have severe back or neck pain, and the pain is so severe that many a times we ask them to get admitted and in the hospital. Now these patients require, number one, rest, number two, medications which are largely oral through mouth, and probably different patients take different duration to become all right. Some take 2 days, 3 days. Some are emotionally disturbed, so they may take longer. When these patients claim go to the insurance company, the first question comes up is, what is the need of admission? So we have to justify, okay, there was pain which was troublesome and patient was, he needed, because it's one of the vital signs. Nobody can live with pain, so we admitted. Then the second question would come, if you were to treat them with oral medications, why did you admit? So, you know, whether we should admit this patient, now this decision making has gradually moved from the healthcare provider to somebody else who is not, you know, who is not technically sound into that. And this and so many such things become a big problem into that. Because insurer's main aim is to, he's into a business model. He has to get more revenue to his company and he has to make less payouts. So there is a conflict where my technical decision of admitting a patient is suffered because of somebody else's ignorance, who is controlling because he is the one who is paying for it. So let us understand different, now for such, there could be different healthcare models. So these are some of the representative models. Like in India, if we talk of Indian model, it is a combined model, a private as well as public sector hospitals healthcare system. Private, as I see, covers around 60 to 70%, and 30% is by the government hospitals. Here, anybody who has insurance can go to any place of their choice. There are no referral systems like other. We'll talk about it. And if somebody goes for government healthcare, then there are norms, there are hospitals, and there are ways. There are limitations also to what kind of care they can take. On the other hand, there are some government institutes like All India Institute or national institutes, which are, you know, leading into such type of healthcare. So these are, but they're very few compared to the size of population we have. Those such institutes are very less. If you go to European Union or like in India, first we talk of American model, it is also similar. So it is still more around 80-90% of it is private healthcare model. And everybody is almost, they have got, USA has got around 80% or maybe more health insurance coverage. So anybody who has health insurance can get admitted to any of the hospitals to whatever extent care they want, they get there. But the flip side of this is those who do not have health care or adequate health care has no place to go really. This is the flip side of American model. European Union has different model. There are university hospitals, most of them private clinics are few. University hospitals are teaching institutes and also the center of where the medical research, laboratory research is being done. All these patients which go, the university hospitals are bound to take all the patients. They cannot refuse, but everybody has to have a health insurance. So European Union policy is like everyone who is a citizen of European Union should have an insurance. Anybody who is traveling to European Union and staying there should have medical insurance for the duration of their stay. So everything is insured. There is almost 100% insurance coverage in European Union model, except those who are illegal immigrants and do not disclose. Now we come to Canadian and British model. This is completely state-owned. They are called as National NHS, National Health System Trust, NHS. And in Canada also, it is entirely government model, like government hospitals. Again, that the coverage of government healthcare model is around 70 to 80%, 90% maybe, and 10% would be those who are super rich, those who do not want to go to public hospital there and want a privilege in, go to private hospital. So all these models have their goods and bads. Like if we talk about an average, a farmer from a village, if they happen to go to All India Institute in Delhi or a similar institute elsewhere, then probably they will be given care to the extent what anywhere else in the world would be. What will be less is the personal touch, because there are so many people. It is difficult for the healthcare system there to, you know, fulfill every requirement of all patients. So they confine only to the medical, technical requirement. Opposite to that, if you go walk into, if we happen to walk into a private healthcare setup, all these cares are taken up care of. Technical as well as social care is taken, but the cost is enormous. So what is, from a healthcare provider's view, how the healthcare economics is affected, what are the factors, what are the people's perception, and what are facts from a doctor's or the healthcare provider's point of view? These services are divided into specialist services, the hospitals and institutions, pharmaceutical industries and their role, the diagnostic tests and medical and surgical treatments, and guarantee. Guarantee is a important word, because I just included it here for the reason that many a times we come across patients who seek medical care from us, and they are ready to spend whatever we tell them, and they ask for guarantee that, okay, we are spending maybe X amount of money on our care, and you claim to be a good doctor, so would you guarantee the outcome? That's from where the guarantee word has come. That what do we do? Can as a doctor I give guarantee for the diseases I'm specialized to treat in? What are the factors why I say the guarantee is not possible? Or what all other things, what other industries which are playing come up with a guarantee? If you buy a car, does it come with a guarantee that nothing will happen to that car? So another important thing here in the healthcare economics is the free spree. Free is a myth. Somebody is paying for whatever is being done. Either it's a taxpayer, or a philanthropist, or an NGO, or something. Somebody is going to pay for it. So when we compare this, that let us talk about the present context about coronavirus test. There is a RT-PCR which cost around I don't know how much, but government has capped it to 4,500. Now we do not know actual cost of this. Maybe the pharmaceutical industry which is producing the kit is charging government 8,000 rupees, 7,000 rupees, 1,000 rupees, we do not know. Government has capped it to 4,500. Now, there might be another hospital which buys it in bulk, or some organization, and start doing these tests at 1,000 rupees. So we compare suddenly, okay, this test is being done for 1,000 rupees, but some private hospital or some laboratory or the government is charging 4,500. Now, this gap cannot exist. If it's a similar type of kit, similar kind of tests, and similar type of specialists who are involved in that care, then this difference cannot be there. Now, since it is related to the health and at such a large extent, maybe government is funding that 3,500 rupees. So what appears to be of 1,000 rupees is actually 4,500 rupees only, but taxpayer, us, or a philanthropist, or somebody else is paying for it. So free healthcare, free medication, cheap healthcare, cheap medication is a myth. The cost, a CT scan machine which does a CT scan costs the same. If a utilizer or a consumer is charged less, that is because it's being funded from somewhere. Specialist services, what are the conflicts? Now, the cost of a specialist. Now, there are conflicts we get to see. Vinith, is it going well? Vinith, are you there? Hello?
Yeah, it's going well.
Okay. Yeah. So, specialist services. Why? It often happens that a specialist in a metro would charge something different for a consultation compared to somebody else. And then there is comparison. Okay, this is so much. Or somebody for a surgical procedure, for an examination might. So, and many a time people compare it with the cost of a mobile phone. Like even an iPhone 10 comes in a particular price. It is charged 70,000 rupees wherever you buy it from. Then why not for healthcare specialist services? Why not for an opinion of a specialist? But can these two things be quantified? Do we like manufacturing of a iPhone 10 is a standard procedure. It is known that what all is going into the manufacturing, what all is the cost of transporting that to a particular place, what are the percentage of the profit, and the referrals or the shares, everything is determined, and then the price is determined. Is it possible, like that business model, is it possible to replicate this here? No, because there are wide range of expenses and skill in term and time that people spend. There are people who spend around 15 to 20 years of their lives becoming what they are, and they start delivering their services. Now, this cannot very easily be quantified into in terms of the amount, charges, or the cost. Then in a particular skill set, in a particular specialty, there are various levels. Some by virtue of the time spent into that, by virtue of the place where people work. So there are different skill sets into that. And again, when I come to the most important point, that some of the things cannot be quantified, whether out of these two, who is a better batsman, who is more popular, who is more well-known, is a different thing. Who is a better batsman, who would perform how in a particular match is not known. So these things cannot be quantified. This is a relevant cartoon I just came across and I included. So in the present scenario, you can have it as a self-explanatory cartoon, which says that the society or the masses are happily willing to shell out that money for a protective gear which hairstylist is wearing, understanding the risk. But you know, similar scenario when arises in the hospital where there is a risk to life, which is many times higher compared to the previous, you know, the first scene. But still, you know, when the cost in the hospital rises, there's a social general disagreement into the people. And that's why when there is a disagreement, a resentment, the functionality of that particular hospital or that healthcare model is affected adversely. Second is hospital and institutions. Now, how does they affect the healthcare business model? I talked about private hospitals or private setups. Many of them have, businessmen or like a businessman who is setting up a hospital is doing it as a business model. He's running another. Let us talk of as an example of Mukesh Ambani, who is an astute businessman. He's running various kind of businesses all across, and he decides to open up Reliance Hospital. So for him, is it a philanthropy? For him, is it a charity, or it's a business model? It's difficult to say unless we really talk to him and see that model working. But for many others, it is a business. It is a business. They want to generate a revenue and profits out of it. And then these hospitals are governed by various permissions and licenses and clearances, which are enormous. For a small hospital, a 10-bedded hospital, the number of permissions and licenses might go up to 30 or even more. And then these hospitals are considered as a commercial entity. They get electricity or other facilities at a commercial rate, like a shop. A shop and a hospital would not have any differences in terms of municipal corporation regulations and so on and so forth. Then the third aspect is competitiveness. When somebody is running a hospital or a business, then they need to compete with their people at par. And this again, this particular thing again calls for certain business rules to be applied. And then the image issues. So I got another interesting cartoon. Many of these are doing rounds and all of us are sharing and agreeing to it also to a large extent. Now, it says the one who created it likes the creativity, like corporate hospitals are tapping the situation. But look it from the hospital's point of view. Now that hospital doesn't have normal occupancy, like a 100-bedded hospital, which used to run at the occupancy of 70 to 80 beds per day, around 70% occupancy, was making good revenues, is now at around 20% or 30%, wherein there are patients who are sick, whose stay in the hospital is indeterminate, their problems are indeterminate. Somebody who has come with a coronavirus infection might also have a liver disease, might also have a kidney disease, might also have a heart disease, or altogether combined, which are worsened by the prevailing situation. Now, these patients, they do not respond to the routine treatment. They require more care for themselves as well as care for their healthcare provider. Earlier, maybe one nurse per day was sufficient to take care of these patients because their medical demands were less. But now in this present situation, it has changed. So when such workforce come into play, the hospitals are obliged to pay to them to disinfect the hospitals again and again. Even, you know, in an unfortunate event of, death of such patients, the process of disposal of the remains, mortal remains, is also so strict and tedious that it also involves an additional cost than always. So if I look from a healthcare provider point of view, this cartoon looks to be absolutely absurd, out of place, or not really representing the actual scenario situation. The third part, important part, is the pharmaceutical, which adds to, I was just researching for this presentation, and I came across that, and our experience also, that up to 50% or 40% of the medical, bills of a illness comprise of cost of the medications at various stages. So half the medical bill, it can be understood, is because of the medications. Now, pharmaceutical industry, or the pricing, or the expensive medicine, which we talk, that we get to hear very often, ki doctor badi mehengi dawai likhta hai. Now, the price of the medicine is not determined by the doctor or the hospital or the healthcare provider. There is an industry, pharmaceutical industry, which runs, controls everything. It controls. The pharmaceutical company decides. Here again, demand and supply factor is not working, which otherwise would work in any other business model. Here still government has some capping on medications, but still the pharmaceutical company doesn't ask a doctor who is the end, penultimate utilizer of that product, about the cost. And for pharmaceutical industry, it is right also, because they are probably researching a molecule, they are doing clinical studies, they are probably hiring experts in the field and spending a lot of money. Professor Vineet would know, he's from the similar background, that what goes into a research of a molecule, probably 10 probable molecules, when the research begins with 10 probable molecules, one of them might end as a end product or a finished product. And So this effect, though it has got an enormous impact on the healthcare economics, but it is an independent entity. It is in the pharmaceutical industry, again, it is governed by business ethics. If some pharmaceutical giant is bringing down a molecule which is very unique, very useful, they are in a position to price the way they want. And patent issues, which are not so pertinent in our setup, but if we go to the European markets, or for that matter, America's, patent is a big issue, and that increases the cost of medication many times. And then again, demand supply relationship. One important thing about patent, I would like to quote one example here, that is of a medicine which we commonly use. The molecule is pregabalin. It comes in a capsule form, and Pfizer USA is the researcher of this molecule. This molecule came around maybe 20 years back. When we read about that molecule, there were around 24 probable molecules which were considered, and over a period of 16 to 17 years of research, this one molecule came in, and Pfizer priced it at, it is still selling in Indian market, it is sold in the name of capsule Lyrica. It is priced at 52 rupees per capsule. Usual regular doses, two capsules per day. Some patients might need more. And there are generics which are available in Indian market. Indian market is a generic market, many of you would know. So there are generics, and major players like Sun Pharma, Cipla, are selling these same generic molecule at a cost of around 5 or 7 rupees per tablet, or even less. Now, the issue is, if it is available, then why a research molecule to be used? There are various factors for that. One is, many of you would agree with me that the efficacy or the profile, a biochemical profile of a research molecule is far different from that of a generic molecules. Generic means there are some things which are less compared to research molecule, and we in our practice see that there are many patients who are not so responsive or unresponsive to the generic molecules, are very much responsive to the research molecule. So when we are on a generic, because you know, market forces force us to use the generic, because this is a cost sensitive market, anybody would be. But when we see that these molecules are not working, and when we talk with our patient to switch over to a research molecule, many times we see dramatic, you know, positive results. And many a times patient understand that, and they agree to shell out more money, which is a burden, of course, but for a product. So I want to say is, when there is a product which is of quality, even in other business models, other economic models, the product which is better, which has more qualities, would be priced higher compared to others which are copy, and there's nothing wrong about it. So this comparison that, okay, the same drug, you see lots of WhatsApp messages doing rounds that, okay, this is the drug, doctor has written an expensive medicine, so let us find out a generic and take. Yes, generic is going to cost less, no doubt about it, but then original has some reason, and this is regarding your health. You're taking something inside, and that is known to be more effective. So how far is such debate or such, you know, blame is justified? Here is something, this is about Coronil or something like that. So I saw this message on WhatsApp. 600 rupaye mein agar corona ka ilaaj ho gaya to allopathy hospitals ke loot ka kya hoga, puri lobby roegi ayurvedic. But has there's nothing against Ayurveda or about Coronil or about Baba Ramdev or any other therapy, but do we see the influx of patient into you know, allopathic style of medicine or allopathic stream of medicine hospitals occupied in treating these patients, and other type of hospitals, or even do we know of single Ayurvedic hospital which is treating, really admitting patients and doing it? Cannot be. So this such type of attitude cannot be opportunistic. It cannot be so. It affects the economy, healthcare mechanisms adversely and detrimentally rather. Now, one more aspect of this is diagnostic tests. Very often we see that, okay, what all tests are, I'm talking from, again, from the healthcare provider's point of view, deciding upon which particular tests are required, or a battery of tests is required, requires a lot of experience and acumen also. Two patients who have got similar type of profile or similar type of disease may not be concluded by similar type of test. It sounds weird, but it happens very often. Sometimes a CT scan followed by MRI is required, one test is required, and day three again similar tests are to be repeated, because there is a lot of dynamics. So, and again, there are lots of you know, tests also. So which to choose, which all in combination to use, that makes these things very, very unclear. And in general, the masses of the people have an opinion about that, okay, some hospital is doing unnecessary tests, or some doctor is doing unnecessary tests, or these tests have been repeated so frequently. So there may be some, you know, unethical aspect into that, but not all. And there are doctors who know why they are really asking for a test, what they are looking for out of the test, and why some negative test has an importance. Like, I would probably ask a patient who has got a back pain for an MRI, because there are certain things in my mind. And when I get a negative means a normal MRI scan. When I'll get that normal MRI scan, I would know, I would have ruled out various things. Vineet, just touch me if I'm overshooting my time. Hello?
No. Chal, abhi toh hai time. Abhi hai time.
You please indicate, because we are towards the end, but if I'm overshooting, I can speed it up. Thank you. So like many doctors really know what, most of them, I would rather rectify myself, that what, which test are they asking for, and what exactly are they looking for into it. Then the second aspect is 50% of that may be 100%. Like, you know, half the test would reach it. Meaning the tests are a corroborative evidence. There is a clinical part of examination, then there are physical examination, and then there are tests. All corroboratively would help the doctor or the hospital to conclude. So a test, like, you know, there are situations wherein the test doesn't say anything, but still doctor tells you, gives you an information, and that happens very often. Another thing is the medical science is still evolving and it's ever changing. What we used to believe earlier was right over a period of time, in the light of new knowledge, we understand is not complete. There is something new. So the tests which were very conclusive earlier may not be so now, or what was not so conclusive earlier now becomes the gold standard. So such type of things keep on happening, and there is nothing unethical or wrong or unknowledgeable about it. No. These tests, again, this quote, very important. As we look ahead, we see further. As we go across these tests, like I said, I give an example of a negative test, that I have something in mind, that is it a possibility, and for that to confirm or to refute that, I do a test. When I see a negative test, that means a normal test, it gives me a further, you know, a view further or an idea further. This is just for an example that how the business model into this effect, like MRI machine, on an average, 3 Tesla MRI machine would cost around 5 to 6 crore. This is a representative that actual cost, what is the cost calculation is, if they do a MRI for 8,000 rupees and they do 10 MRIs per day, then at the end of 5 or 6 years, they would break even the cost of the machine. Now, this center is giving an offer price as a business model. What are the discounts which automobile industry or a garment industry or a shoe industry would give? He is forced to do that because he's applying those business models to healthcare model. Now, if 8,000 per MRI, 10 MRIs every day for 5 years is going to break even the cost of the machine alone, then how much time or means this offer price is going to get? And then MRI machine is not only the cost of MRI machine. MRI machine is also the cost of technicians, the maintenance, electricity, the place where the machine is placed, and, you know, the most importantly, the doctor who is interpreting those results and drawing the conclusion. So, you know, estimate the cost. One more aspect of all this is, you know, medical surgical treatment. I brought in this because very often we get to see that, okay, patients come to us and they ask, doctor, I have so and so things, and I want you to, when I tell them that, okay, you need to undergo a surgery, that is the right thing, they say, no, we would prefer to take medicine. We would like to be treated by medicine. Mujhe operation nahi chahiye, main dawai se theek karna chahta hoon. Which is good. Nobody wants to be operated. But do we have such options? Like, there are, over a period of time, the science has evolved and we have been able to differentiate into what all diseases can be treated medically and what all diseases can be treated surgically. That's why these specialties have come up, and they are further, you know, branching. More and more branching is coming up. So is it for the patient to choose what they want? They may have a desire, but that might not be the right thing. So when these patients have in their mind that they want a medical treatment and their doctor tells that, no, you need a surgery, somewhere it comes into their mind that this is for the sake of making profits or earning money, it's unethical. Then again, you know, which is not right. Again, then treatment or treatment modalities or approaches are different for different people. Some are aggressive physicians, some are aggressive surgeons, some are conservative. Their experiences are different from others. So though there are broad guidelines to all the treatment modalities, but then there are individual variations to it. So these treatment modalities are physician specific, the healthcare taker or the doctor specific, as well as patient specific. What I did for my last patient, I may not do the same for the next patient who has a similar disease, because the patient is different. I operated upon my previous patient because he was 40 year old, healthy athlete, and he could take the surgery well. But then my next patient with a similar disease is a 70-year-old retired person with a heart ailment and the kidney is not functioning well, and he is hypertensive, which is he has not taken care for the last 40 years. So disease is same, but then the approach because of various factors becomes different, and this is absolutely justified. So there comes the point, absolute objectivity becomes difficult. Okay, this type of disease, like putting into a system and then taking out results and applying, is not possible. We cannot put, you know, patients into boxes. Okay, this is there, okay, this kind of treatment, and that is there, and that kind of treatment cannot be done. So for a soldier in action, it is difficult to bind in a rule. The one who is standing on the borders and trying to eliminate the enemy, you cannot tell him to count his bullets and shoot. Okay, your soldier is given quota of 20 bullets, and then we ask him to eliminate the enemy in those 20 and not ask for more. It cannot be. It's not possible. And that's where more and more patients are going to internet for medical advice. To keep my practice going, I changed my name to Dr. Google, and that really worked. So discussing about all these things, what are the feathers and the blots? I would say that the size of healthcare economy, healthcare system, mechanism is massive, and it is of a reasonably good quality. It's of a reasonably good quality. To add to that, medical tourism is a verification or proof that we are providing a very good quality of healthcare in a reasonable. We get to see many patients traveling from mainly Middle East, the Gulf countries, from whole of Africa, and from Eastern European countries who travel, who are equidistant from Europe, from UK, which used to be hot destinations for medical care for from people from these regions, but now they are diverted to India for healthcare. So that is an indication of a reasonably good quality at a reasonable price. It is priced well. Also one important feather is upward trends and overall indicators. If you look from the basic healthcare indicators to the higher indicators of a high or a quality healthcare, change in the basic indicators of maternal mortality or infant mortality, or the rate of infectious diseases spread, or availability of the medications for this, or maybe malaria, dengue, so on and so forth, or some indicators like utilization of MRI, you know, purchase of MRI machines in India and their installation, or purchase and installation and utilization of the high-end medical equipments, be it a laser, be it a microscope with high intensity visualization, or maybe robotics, or use of medical materials like various implants, joint replacement implants, or cardiac pacemakers, or stents. So all these are utilization when they are being utilized at par with many of the advanced healthcare system, which we believe is advanced. It indicates that amount of that quality of work is being done in our scenario as well. If you look at the flip side of the blots, there is still a lack in standardization of the care. We are not sure whether the same kind of care is available in various places for similar kind of diseases. That standardization is still not there. One important thing I see into this is the penetration of the system. As we talked earlier, that this system is mostly confined to the urban areas or semi-urban, not beyond that. And if we go deeper, which still is the large part of our country, the penetration is very less. And third important thing is the economic coverage. Many people, a large population, is still not adequately covered. Even in the urban settings, even the people who are insured, their insurance coverages, we many times feel that are not adequate to cover most of the diseases. They may be good enough to take care of the common diseases. What happens when these patients encounter with some more complicated diseases, or they require an extended stay in the hospital? Their economic coverage is not sufficient enough. Comparison disparity, this thing came to my mind that, okay, healthcare industry or healthcare sector, whom should we compare it with the industry, automobile, or the infrastructure sector, or with similar kind of thing, or with the showbiz, sports, politics, public life comparison? Is it possible and is it valid? So I would like to conclude here that being a healthcare provider is pride. It's a very, very a proud feeling, and the society reciprocates it by and large. We and people like me into this type of work that understand that society reciprocates it to a very large extent, and we clearly understand that healthcare sector cannot be 100% business model, profit oriented, rapidly growth oriented. It cannot be that model. It has to be a socialistic model. It has to be is a mixed item of model. What I emphasize is health is to be considered as an economic, important economic indicator, and it is related. I even have this idea in the mind that health should move from the health ministry to finance ministry, because health determines the economic outcome or industrial outcome or the growth outcome or whatever. How this can very well be put down on a paper. So it should be considered as a very important economic indicator. Third observation is insurance or the similar instrument, Ayushman or some insurance kind or a social security kind of system has a very important role in this sector. This is largely missing, and wherein in insurance there is a concept works that if 100% people contribute to it, then at any point of time, not more than 10 or 15% people are going to fall sick and utilize these services. Now, who are those 15% is not certain. So everybody should contribute. Those 85% who never needed it should not feel that their contribution is wasteful, because anybody could be in that 15%. And then this model can sustain itself. And dynamic policies and continuous efforts are needed for its evolution. Like anywhere else, they are needed here also. Thank you very much. Thank you very much, everyone, for a patient hearing. And I conclude that is what I wanted to present here. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Vandana?
Thank you, sir, for this valuable information. We'll go forward to the question answer session. So we have a question from YouTube Live from Yash Agrawal. He asks, there has been a large number of cesarean surgeries, MRI scans, private hospital cost as they want. There is no regulation. Yes.
Right.
We have feeling to avoid hospitals as they charge too much in one line.
Right.
People have lost trust. Is hospitals working towards establishing trust?
Yes, there is a general. Am I audible to them also, Vandana? I'm audible to everyone, right?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Yeah. So yes, there is a general understanding, general perception in the society that cesareans are unnecessary. Number one, MRI costs too much. And then there are, as I also included in my presentation, that diagnostic tests are being done unnecessarily, and the private hospital costs too much. So accepted all these. Now, when we say too much compared to what? Is it too much compared to Indore model or to Delhi model or to the American model, or too much compared to what is that parameter which determines that MRI is too much? Let us take an example of MRI at a government medical college hospital, which cost rupees 1,000, and in a private hospital, which cost 8,000 rupees. So 8,000 is expensive, right? But you should understand, as I said, that in a government medical college also, the cost of doing an MRI is 8,000 rupees or 7,000 rupees. The user or the consumer is paying 1,000 rupees because this is being funded by somebody. The government funds it. So pricing is again subjective. It is expensive compared to something which is priceless. But if we go to America, probably MRI is costing $1,500. So compare it with that. It is the same machine, similar machine, designed in Germany, manufactured in China, installed in India and USA, with similar type of properties. similar type of images. So pricing is a very debatable thing. What is there? And when probably the insurance companies come in largely, they can to some extent regulate this price. I would slightly disagree to say that they cost too much unless we have a parameter to compare it with. As far as cesarean operations are concerned, there are indications which has evolved over a period of time. Now there are various factors why a surgeon decides to perform surgeries. That list is long. Doing surgery for the sake of generating revenue, it's a perception which is difficult to really break. Now there is difference, I would say, like if you are in UK, if somebody, a lady is in UK in an NHS, government health system, she is more likely to have a normal birth compared to in US where they are into the private health setup, where they she is likely to undergo cesarean. Now, is it solely determined by the cost? Not probably. There are other indications also. There is a debate. Somebody might say in government hospitals, probably they have fixed schedule. So they fix, they are working from 9 to 5, and after 5, probably they don't want to work. So they put all these patients onto the waiting list for a normal birth. So this is a debate which cannot have a direct answer. But it is not wrong to believe that most of the doctors are doing it from the indications because there are broad guidelines. And if we see more patients who go to these hospitals become all right, then they do not become. So that is also one of the indications that things are being done as per broadly accepted guidelines. We say then the standard of care at that point of time.
All right, sir. Thank you.
Yeah.
We have another question from Girish Soni, sir. He asks, do you feel that there must be European healthcare system that is getting everybody insured in India as well?
Yes, that's a good question. This is one of the solutions wherein everybody over a period of time, probably India will have to move to that point. But if we talk of, 100% insurance coverage, which would be good, the cost in Europe for such insurances is very high. On an average, a family of four would be able to contribute to that insurance honestly without defaulting on it.
Okay, sir. Next question is from Fozia Aziz. She asked, Ayushman Bharat is covering 10 crore people only.
Yes.
As per you, what the government must do to facilitate healthcare to the population on the base of the pyramid, that is poor and lower middle class?
The coverage of Ayushman Bharat is more than 10 crore. I think, as I understand, around 40 to 50 crore citizens have been covered under it. It's a novel scheme, but still it doesn't cover everyone, number one. Second, the place where the Ayushman Bharat facilities are given, most of the private hospitals, private setups are not in a position to cater to these patients. Why? Because the allotment as per the Ayushman Bharat is not at par with what are the expenses in these hospitals. Now, some private hospital accept this scheme because they have been obliged by government in the form of a land or some other, contributions in the hospital where they can probably meet up the ends. Like in Indore, SAMES Hospital, Aurobindo Hospital is able to run this scheme because it's a charity kind of hospital wherein they have other sources of income also and where they can cater. But a private hospital in that way finds it difficult to cater to, because like in my specialty, if for a brain surgery or a brain tumor, if the patient has been given a quota of 2 lakh rupees, and if I happen to treat such patients, because of the uncertainty of the disease, uncertainty of the extent of their stay in the hospital and comorbidities, it is difficult to really predict that much amount of duration of in the hospital or that much amount of quota of money is sufficient or not. However, only such scheme which is going to incorporate more than 80 or 90% of the citizens are required, and they are only going to work. How that still is a matter of debate. maybe those who can afford insurances should get it, irrespective of their health history, their family's health history, they should get it. Rest should be covered. As far as the people at the bottom of the pyramid are concerned, government has established national institutes, government medical colleges, offices, hospitals with, you know, lots of facilities which are available at that cost, which people spend. So these are remarkable places. We may criticize as much as we like, but these are the centers which train future doctors. These are the centers which are treating people from the lowest socioeconomic strata. These are the centers which are providing them care which nowhere else can be given at the cost which these people incur or the society incurs. So we should laud at these institutes. We require more, no doubt about it, because we have got an enormous number, but still these centers are to be appreciated.
Sir, there is one more question.
Okay.
There is much superstition regarding health. So what steps are taken by medical specialists? Like, generally we ignore few medical conditions as per our belief. So what can be done for that?
That's a good question. If you recall the beginning of my presentation, I said the state of health is default. It is underestimated. But then, like everything else, like your house, your automobile, your finances, everything needs maintenance and care and a foresight. Health requires that too. So being healthy is good, but you know, being healthy now doesn't ensure health for always. There are general lifestyle related issues and advisories. There are food related advisories. There are, you know, risk factor related advisories, and one should be very sensitive about it. As we nurture our wealth, we should also nurture our health. Most of the times, unfortunately, we think of a doctor or a hospital or a health or the issue of health till we are in a situation where the health is threatened. This has to be avoided. We have to understand health as one of, as I said, it is one of the important economic indicators. If today I fall sick, if I'm out of work, my family has an issue with our income. So it is that important.
Okay, sir. Another question is, nowadays, corona is a very big disease, and all the medical staff is focusing on that.
Right.
So do you think on the basic level, the other patients suffering from other diseases are lacking medical facilities?
Right. I understand. Yes, that was a big concern in the beginning when the things begin in the later half of March, when we really started understanding the problem. This was a big problem. There was a panic among masses as well as in the medical staff and the hospitals. We did not know what actually was happening at that time. Over a period of time, we also, like, you know, as doctors were frightened to go to hospital and see patient because we did not know who is infected, who is likely to infect others. Similarly, patients were also averse from coming to hospital or seeking healthcare. So some part of it was done by telemedicine, which came as a blessing. Most of the doctors remain connected to their patients indirectly through video calls and through general calls. Hospital also did that. Some of the patients suffered initially because of the panic and because of overestimation of the risk of corona. But now, since last 1.5 months, things have fallen in place again. Administration's lead to differentiate hospitals between different categories was to some extent right move, because those who were not infected by the by the coronavirus could be taken into the hospitals which are labeled otherwise, and gradually over a period of time things are falling in place. But yes, initially, yes, some patient did suffer.
Okay, sir, thank you so much, sir. Here we have our question answer session.
Thank you very much. I'm glad.
Thank you, sir, for question answer. लास्ट में मैं कंक्लूड करना चाहूंगा थोड़ा. वैसे तो सर आपने सब कुछ समझा ही दिया है, कि आपने पहले तो ये बताया कि डॉक्टर प्रणव ने ये सबसे पहले समझाया कि हेल्थी रहना बहुत जरूरी है. हेल्थ अच्छी रखने के लिए कुछ नहीं लगता है, बट हमें फिर भी हेल्दी रहने के लिए प्रयास करना चाहिए. अगर हेल्दी नहीं भी रहे और बीमार भी हो जाते हैं तो हमें अच्छे ट्रीटमेंट की तरफ जाना चाहिए. उस अच्छे ट्रीटमेंट में कॉस्ट लगती है, उसके बारे में सर ने समझाया. वो कॉस्ट कहाँ से क्यों बढ़ती है, क्या डिफरेंट मॉडल्स हैं, क्या क्या कॉस्ट कहाँ कहाँ से कॉस्ट जनरेट होती है, हमको सारी मिथ समझाएं कि कॉस्ट बढ़ी नहीं होने का मतलब ये नहीं कि हॉस्पिटल हमेशा चार्ज ज्यादा कर रहा है या डॉक्टर हमेशा चार्ज ज्यादा कर रहा है. इट इज डेफिनेटली कि अगर कॉस्ट है तो कहीं ना कहीं से वो बियर हो रही है, या तो डायरेक्टली कस्टमर से हो रही है, पेशेंट से हो रही है, या कहीं और से आ रही है. बट नीड नॉट टू वरी अबाउट दोस, वी हैव टू कीप हेल्दी. तो हमें बेस्ट ट्रीटमेंट लेना चाहिए और उसके लिए सारे प्रयास करने चाहिए. थैंक यू डॉक्टर फॉर सच अ नाइस सेशन, सच अ ज्ञानवर्धक नॉलेजेबल आपका सेशन के लिए.
सो थैंक यू प्रोफेसर विनीत, थैंक यू वेरी मच.
सो over to the rest of the team. क्या सेशन हमें यहीं खत्म करना है?
थैंक यू डॉक्टर विनीत.
यस
हाँ, मैं डॉक्टर बीके तिवारी, एनएसएस और एनसीसी की इस ज्वाइंटली दो दिन की जो वर्कशॉप, उसके पे अत्यंत ही सारगर्भित चर्चा हुई. हमारे जो विद्वान वक्ता, हमारे रिसोर्स पर्सन रहे, वो भी काफी उन्होंने कुछ कुछ आंसरों के, जैसे मैं अभी देख रहा था कि हमारे डॉक्टर साहब ने अभी इतने बोल्डली जवाब दिए हैं, और उनका बहुत सारी जो चीजें जो उनके उसके अंदर शामिल थी हमारे इनके प्रेजेंटेशन में, वो शायद मुझे लगता है कि इस तरह के बहुत सारे आंसर हम लोगों को कभी मिल नहीं पाते हैं, जो कि उन्होंने बहुत सारी अंदर की और बाहर की भी बातें की हुई हैं. प्राइवेट की भी बात की, आयुर्वेद की भी बात की, एलोपैथी, सर्जरी, डिफरेंट डिफरेंट टाइप की. ये एक एक्सपर्ट डॉक्टर ही जो अंदर और बाहर हर तरह की जानकारी रखता है, वही हमें दे सकता है. तो विशेषकरी मैं डॉक्टर प्रणव जी को बहुत बहुत थैंक यू बोलूंगा उनके खालसे से, क्योंकि ये कुछ प्रोफेशनल सीक्रेट जैसी कुछ बातें होती हैं जो कि बाहर के आदमी को उतनी जानकारी नहीं होती है उसके लिए. तो आज का जो हमारा ये दो दिन की वर्कशॉप थी, उसके लिए हम सबसे पहले तो हमारे जो आधार स्तंभ हैं, हमारे डायरेक्टर साहब जिन्होंने हमें इसकी परमिशन भी दी, मोटिवेट भी किया, और उनको हमारा मार्गदर्शन भी किया. मैं अपने डॉक्टर राकेश सक्सेना सर को बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद करना चाहता हूं हमारी पूरी टीम की तरफ से, कि उन्होंने हमें ये अवसर दिया कि हम इस तरह की एक चर्चा को ऑनलाइन वर्कशॉप का हम आयोजन करें, जिसमें कि हमारे एनसीसी और एनएसएस के न केवल वॉलेंटियर बल्कि मध्य प्रदेश और मध्य प्रदेश के बाहर के भी बहुत सारे ऐसे फैकल्टी भी हमारे साथ जुड़े हुए हैं, बहुत सारे स्टूडेंट जुड़े हुए हैं, उनको इस तरह के अलग अलग क्षेत्र की जानकारी मिली हुई है. फर्स्ट सेशन में डॉक्टर आदित्य बिल्लोरे जी ने हमें बताया था पोजीशनिंग वन सेल, जिसमें उन्होंने ये बताया था हमें कि केवल हमारे सोच लेने से हमारा स्थान बड़ा नहीं होता समाज के अंदर, बल्कि हमें समाज और राष्ट्र के लिए कुछ ना कुछ करके दिखाना होता है. ऊंचा स्थान हर कोई चाहता है, लेकिन जब कर्तव्यों की बात आती है तो उसके बारे में नहीं सोचते. तो पोजीशनिंग वन सेल, आप अपना स्थान बना सकते हैं, लेकिन आपको समाज और राष्ट्र के लिए कुछ करना पड़ेगा. उसके बाद में जो हमारे दूसरे सेशन के वक्ता थे मिस्टर संदीप महतो जी, जो भारत कॉलिंग से थे, वो एक अच्छे इंजीनियर भी थे, और समाज की समस्याओं के बारे में उन्होंने बताया. उन्होंने एक बहुत अच्छा क्वेश्चन जो हमें लगा समझ में आया, वो ये उन्होंने यही बताया कि एज ए इंजीनियर, क्या केवल डिग्री लेने से हम इंजीनियर बन जाए? जब तक हम समाज की समस्याओं के बारे में ना सोचें, उसके समाधान के बारे में ना सोचें, और समाधान भी ऐसा जो हर किसी को अफोर्डेबल हो, गवर्नमेंट को भी और एक कॉमन पीपल ऑफ द सोसाइटी सभी को हो। तो ये उन्होंने भी बड़ा ही सारगर्भित उनका 3 सेशन था उनका, मेरा तिरंगा कुछ रोचक तत्व, इसके ऊपर उन्होंने इतनी अच्छी अच्छी बातें बताई जो वास्तव में हमें मालूम नहीं थी, और उनके द्वारा बताए जाने के बाद ही हमें बहुत सारी तथ्य हमारे तिरंगा के बारे में, उसके सम्मान के बारे में, बहुत सारे जो स्टैंडर्ड हैं हमारे, उसके मानक हैं हमारे तिरंगा झंडा के, उनके बारे में बताया। बहुत ही एक हिंदुस्तान के एक नागरिक के तौर पे हम सभी को उन्होंने बहुत गाइड किया है। और चौथे हमारे वक्ता डॉक्टर प्रणव बोर्डगांवकर जी, इन्होंने तो मतलब ये इतना अच्छा बताया कि एक समझ पैदा हुई एज ए नॉट ओनली एज ए पेशेंट बट एज ए एक एज ए पर्सन, क्योंकि सबको जानकारी होना चाहिए हेल्थ केयर एक ऐसा विषय है, और अभी का तो ये कोरोना काल में तो ये हेल्थ रिलेटेड इशू हर किसी के ऊपर है, टॉप प्रायोरिटी पर इसी को, क्योंकि जब हम हमारे पास पैसा होता है और रुतबा होता है, सब चीज होती है, सब कुछ कमा लेते हैं, अगर हमारे पास हेल्थ नहीं है तो वो सब चीज बेकार है। क्योंकि एक कहावत है पुरानी कि अपने मरे महाप्रलय, व्यक्ति खुद अगर संसार में नहीं रहता है तो उसके लिए तो संसार ही खत्म हो गया। आप ऐसे व्यक्ति से पूछिए जिनके पास में अरबों खरबों लाखों करोड़ों की संपत्ति है लेकिन वो सपोज पैरालाइज हो चुके हुए हैं। डॉक्टर साहब के सामने ऐसे अक्सर बहुत सारे पेशेंट आते हैं जो दुनिया की हर चीज खरीद सकते हैं लेकिन अच्छा स्वास्थ्य नहीं खरीद सकते। तो मुझे लगता है कि हमारे NCC और NSS के वॉलंटियर्स के अलावा हमारे विद्यार्थी फैकल्टी सभी को हेल्थ कॉन्शियस तो होना ही चाहिए। एक अच्छे स्वस्थ शरीर में लोग कहते हैं अच्छा स्वस्थ मस्तिष्क होता है, और मस्तिष्क कितना कैसा होना चाहिए हमारे न्यूरोलॉजिस्ट से ज्यादा तो कौन बता पाएगा हमें। इसलिए हमने तो और हमारे विद्यार्थी हमारे शिक्षकों के लिए हमारा जो मेंटल गेम होता है हमारी मेंटल एक्सरसाइज होती है उसके लिए ही डॉक्टर साहब का जो उद्बोधन है वो बहुत ही अच्छा रहा। तो हम अपने सभी विद्वान वक्ताओं को बिल्कुल हृदय से अपनी टीम की तरफ से कॉलेज की तरफ से बहुत बहुत हार्दिक धन्यवाद करते हैं, और हम उनसे आशा करते हैं हमारे जब कभी भी हम ऐसे और प्रोग्राम करेंगे अगर समय हो तो हमारे लिए जरूर वो थोड़ा सा वक्त निकालेंगे। तीसरी बात आती है हमारे जो साथी लोग हैं डॉक्टर मनीष जायसवाल जी जो हमारे कन्वीनर हैं, डॉक्टर नीतीश गुप्ता जी हैं, विनीत सिंह जी हैं, और हमारे गिरीश सोनी जी हैं। बहुत मेहनत की इन्होंने, वॉलंटियर से कोऑर्डिनेट किया, डायरेक्टर साहब के साथ में कोऑर्डिनेट किया, सभी लोगों से किया, तभी से हम उनको भी हमारी अपनी टीम है जो वो हमारी टीम है हम उनको भी कहते हैं कि हम आप लोगों ने बहुत अच्छा काम किया है, हमारे साथ में काम किया है वो भी है। और इसके बाद में जो सबसे ज्यादा इम्पोर्टेंट है जो हमारे लिए हमारे कुछ स्टूडेंट कोऑर्डिनेटर हैं, दिन रात लग के काम किया है, और हमारी टीम इवन हमारे डायरेक्टर साहब ने भी उनकी तारीफ की है, फर्स्ट सेशन में भी उन्होंने बहुत तारीफ की थी, हमारे बच्चों ने बहुत क्योंकि टेक्निकली उन्होंने बहुत वर्क किया। अभी भी हमारे ये सभी वॉलंटियर जो है ना अभी भी लगे हुए हैं, सब लोग अपनी अपनी जगह पे, खासतौर से वंदना अग्रवाल है, मुस्कान गुप्ता है, हर्ष अग्रवाल है, राजन गुप्ता है, अदिति नामदेव, अंशुल चौरसिया वगैरह और हर्ष अग्रवाल है, इन लोगों ने बहुत मेहनत की है, सभी ने एक दूसरे के साथ कोऑर्डिनेशन जो किया है। कुछ हमारे रिसोर्स पर्सन थे जो इतने IT फ्रेंडली नहीं, उन्होंने बहुत काम किया है काम। इसके अलावा हमारे कुछ NSS के वॉलेंटियर अर्शलीन भाटिया हैं, माधव खंडेलवाल हैं, अंकित दीक्षित, इसके अलावा और भी है जिन्होंने हमारी NSS टीम के साथ में कोऑर्डिनेशन किया। इन सभी बच्चों को और हमारे बहुत जो सबसे ज्यादा इम्पोर्टेंट है, सबसे ज्यादा इम्पोर्टेंट क्या थे कि अगर पार्टिसिपेंट नहीं हो तो कौन सा प्रोग्राम कैसा प्रोग्राम। तो सबसे हमारे टॉप पर होते हैं, जैसे एक हॉस्पिटल होती है ना, हॉस्पिटल में अगर आने वाले नहीं आएंगे तो किसके लिए हॉस्पिटल, स्कूल में अगर शिक्षक हो विद्यार्थी ना हो तो किसके लिए। तो हमारे लिए जो हमारे जो पार्टिसिपेंट्स है वो हमारे लिए सर्वोपरि है। क्यों, लास्ट में मैंने उनको लिए इसलिए बोला कि जैसे आपने देखा होगा कि जो हम लास्ट में बोलते हैं ना वो हमें ज्यादा याद रहता है, उसी के ऊपर हम ज्यादा ध्यान देते हैं। तो हमारे जो पार्टिसिपेंट्स हैं हम अपनी टीम की तरफ से कॉलेज की तरफ से उनको बिल्कुल हृदय से उनको थैंक यू कहना चाहते कि आप लोग आए और आपने बड़ा इंटरेक्टिव सेशन, हर सेशन में मतलब लाइन लगी रहती थी क्वेश्चन आंसर की। अभी जैसे डॉक्टर साहब ने अभी तो देख ही लिया हुआ लगातार एक, और इतने अच्छे अच्छे क्वेश्चन आए, इतने मतलब ऐसे आए कि उनसे सभी का ज्ञान बढ़ा। तो इन सभी की तरफ से हमारी तरफ से और कॉलेज की तरफ से हमारी टीम की तरफ सभी के लिए धन्यवाद। इसके अलावा भी डायरेक्टली इनडायरेक्टली और भी जिन लोगों ने हमें सहयोग किया है, सपोर्ट किया हुआ है, हो सकता है उनके कुछ के नाम छूट रहे हों, हम उनको भी धन्यवाद कहना चाहते हैं। इसके अलावा लास्ट में अभी सभी वॉलंटियर्स के लिए कि इसके अंदर एक फीडबैक फॉर्म आपको दिया जाएगा, हमारा आप सभी से अनुरोध है कि आप फीडबैक फॉर्म जरूर भरें। फीडबैक फॉर्म बड़ा इंटरेक्टिव है, जिन लोगों ने सेशन अटेंड किया हुआ है डेफिनेटली वो बड़े आराम से कर पाएंगे, क्योंकि आपका जो एक सर्टिफिकेट आपको मिलने वाला है वो इसके ऊपर डिपेंड करेगा। अगर आप फीडबैक फॉर्म नहीं भरते हैं, नहीं देते हैं, तो हमें ऐसा लगेगा कि शायद आपने अटेंड नहीं किया। तो अगर कोई बच्चा छूट जाए, कोई पार्टिसिपेंट छूट जाए, तो उस पर फिर कोई ऑब्जेक्शन नहीं हो पाएगा। इसलिए हमारा सभी पार्टिसिपेंट से अनुरोध है, बार बार अनुरोध है कि वो फीडबैक फॉर्म भरें। और इसके बाद और साथ में ये भी कहते हैं कि आगे भी हमारे ऐसे NCC, NSS, लाइब्रेरी और सभी तरफ से हमारे ऐसे सेशन चलते रहेंगे। कॉलेज की तरफ से और भी सेशन चल रहे हैं, हमारा आपसे अनुरोध है कि सभी सेशन में हमारे लिए अटेंड करें और हमारे विद्वान वक्ताओं को ध्यान से सुने। थैंक यू वेरी मच, ऑल द बेस्ट, थैंक यू, जय हिंद जय भारत।
आओ।